In this chapter, we're going to focus on the workflows connected to bringing assets into Unreal. Once we've brought them in, we will discuss using and modifying them inside of Unreal. Finally, we'll wrap up by looking a little bit at the rendering and performance areas inside of the engine. Meshes, modularity, and management. There are many different existing workflows for bringing assets into Unreal Engine. This topic will overlap with and be revisited often in future lessons. For example, in the third edX course, there will be a section on collaboration, as well as in the fourth course, I will have a section on optimization and packaging. I've also put a link into this managing content document into Unreal. So let's open that up and scroll down. As you can see, there's a lot of content guides, and we're going to cover most of these throughout the different courses. However, there's going to be a few like Speed Tree, which is specialized for foliage and trees, as well as Shotgun, which we're going to probably leave on the side. And if they specifically overlap your workflows, you know where you can find information on them. Let's move back into the overview presentation. Unreal Engine has a growing number of tools for building assets in the engine. However, meshes are still one of the core ones still brought in from outside of the engine. In addition to 3D meshes, the blue column shows the other assets that are still mainly created outside of Unreal. For this course, we will mainly focus on static mesh FBX workflows. However, in the future courses, we will implement all the assets listed in both the blue as well as the orange columns in the Unreal courses. Let's move on to multiple input methods. There are a growing number of methods for bringing assets into Unreal. A lot of them are specialized use case scenarios. However, the most important one for this course, which has a wide range of applications, is the FBX format, which was developed by Autodesk and has the ability to carry a lot of additional data and functionality, which we will go over. Other ones that I will review in later courses will be the Alembic Cache, the DataSmith, which can be used to bring entire pre-constructed scenes into the engine. The LiDAR Point Cloud plugin is amazing because it can be used to bring in huge amounts of visual information efficiently. Finally, as we move into the future, I see a greater need for the USD, Universal Scene Description, interchange format for sharing large amounts of information between applications. As with other slides, links to the additional information and documentation will be provided in the notes section for each of these important input methods. There are three common mesh geometry actor types. This chapter will mainly focus on the static mesh and brush actors. However, there will be a whole chapter dedicated to skeletal mesh actors in the second edX course. The icons pictured are what you can look for when looking in the world outliner inside the engine. Now let's talk about the FBX static mesh pipeline. The first line is a reminder to check and use the specific version compatible with Unreal. Now I'll mention this again as we configure our FBX, but it's very important to use the tested and approved version. Some of my students in the past have forgotten and then have gotten some strange problems. The two colorized chunks break the properties that are set up for the FBX static mesh into components that are usually done outside of Unreal and inside of Unreal. Having said that, these steps can often be accomplished in various and flexible ways, as well as many of them can overlap between outside and inside of Unreal, but I'm going to give you a typical workflow. So basically, outside of Unreal, you can set the pivot point, do triangulation and geometry checks, set up your UVs, your smoothing groups, set your material channels and set up textures, then also specify your levels of detail. HLODs now are more of a thing inside of Unreal. Inside of Unreal, you set up your collisions. Light maps are typically auto set. You can specify sockets and do vertex colors. I'm going to have a whole separate chapter on pipelines and collaboration. So this is a great starting point, but then we'll move on to accelerating this in a further chapter. Once we've brought in our static meshes, we will go into the static mesh editor and we'll show where you can see the light maps, your UV channels, your material channels. We'll also talk about the new streaming virtual texturing features, as well as levels of detail and HLODs. Then we're going to go and talk about our collision boxes. We'll talk about efficiencies, the difference between spheres, capsules, cubes, and simplified collision dops. We'll also talk about things to be careful about, convex versus concave collision caveats. And finally, we are going to move on to optimizations. In the optimization section, we're mainly going to give an introduction to some of the tools that we will cover later in additional courses, where we will start to identify complex processes that could affect your visualizations or gameplay. And we'll talk a little bit about the difference in hardware and software and the interplay between those two. And finally, we're going to focus a lot on diagnostics as well as optimizations, because this is a core tool set to understand and get good at. Optimizations will exist in all of the areas that we're going to cover in every course. The polycounts, lighting materials, rendering, animations, and simulations, as well as blueprint programming. All right, so that's a really great overview of where we're going to go with this chapter. Let's jump in and get started.